Come on, let me pass the little. See you on the left, right, at the middle. Brothers and my sisters, this is me again, the elder Clifford Jefferson L. Bay, from the House of Plantagenet under the rulership of King Godfrey V, the Count of Anjou. I'm here with another lesson today about the origin of this land and who this land belongs to in lieu of a lodeo title. I'm specifically talking about Jersey, identified now as what we call New Jersey. And I notice a lot of people don't subscribe to this channel. And I know that's just based off ignorance, because we've been conformed to a lot of information that has been given by brothers and sisters who have not done the research. As I said before, and I'm gonna say it again, he who writes your books sets your timeline. Now, a lot of our brothers and sisters, which we are now called elders, who are passed away and long gone, did the best with what they had. But they were still identified as indentured people. You know, we have really no historical record or proof to solidify or validate anything pertaining to who we are as a people, other than what was given to us by recorded history, brought down from what we call the Europeans. I want to let you know that Europeans and England or Anglo-Saxons are not the same people. Some people think they are, but they are not. Here's an article here from the Middlesex County Chosen Board of Freeholders. And we know that a freeholder is not a lodeo, as we should know. They only have an interest in the land by way of a title or a deed, but they don't have the rights to the land by way of what we call a lodeo or fee and tail. I've gave previous videos pertaining to this from an English perspective, not according to statutes and ordinances and codes. I identified this landmass according to historical records pertaining to the land which was identified prior to it being given charters to those who now colonized, known as the British monarch system. But let's hear it from them. Here you see the title, History Buffs, The Hitchhiker's Guide to Middlesex County. Scroll down. You can look it up yourself if you want to. Here you see the Middlesex County Board of Chosen Freeholders, Christopher D. Rafano, Freeholder Director, Ronald G. Rios, Deputy Director, Cal Barrett Bellantane, Stefan J. Delina, H. James Polos, Charles E. Tamaro, and Balinquita B. Valentine. Forgive me if I'm pronouncing the names wrong. Compiled by and written by Walter. Let me blow this up for you. Compiled by Walter D. D'Angelo Esquire, County Administrator from 1994 to 2008. The following individuals contributed to the preparation of this book. As you can see here, Clerk of Board and Chosen Freeholders, Margaret E. Pemberton. And once, if you pull this up, you can read it for yourself, but for the sake of time, I'm going to move on. Here you have the table of contents. So you can see it, okay. Table of contents. Introduction, name, land, prehistoric Middlesex County, climate and wildlife, first human inhabitants, the Lenape Native Americans, or so-called Native Americans, European exploration and settlement, A, the Dutch, page 15, and B, the English, page 18, and then you get to the American Revolution when America declared its independence under the British monarch system. And then we get on down to the late 18th, 19th, and 20th century. Okay? But what's the most important is that when you're dealing with European exploration and settlement, they're not talking about English colonizing because this was already England, because England one gave charges out to the so-called colonized under the British colonies. If you see here, European exploration and settlement, the Dutch were people identified as the Anglo-Saxon Dutch. We're going to get into that in a second. But I just wanted to go through this article. All right? What's the most prominent about this article is the introduction. Guys should be able to see that. It says Middlesex County, New Jersey, is located midway between Boston and Washington, D.C. Also midway between New York City and Philadelphia. It is the center of the state of New Jersey, stretching from the Rahway River south to Mercer and Monmouth County lines, and from Raritan Bay west of Somerset County lines. The predominant geographic features of the county is the Raritan River, which flows the entire width of the county from west to east, actually forming part of the Middlesex and Somerset County line. It is navigable from its south at the Raritan Bay to New Brunswick. The central location of the county is the presence of the Raritan River within its boundaries, having been key factors in the original settlement and subsequent growth in Middlesex County. Go a little further. One second. Come on, let's scroll up. The name. The name Middlesex County, New Jersey was named after the original Middlesex County located in southeast England. Now, when you look up Middlesex County in England, the only word term come up is Middlesex. And back in England, they never called them counties, they were called shires. So the first term county was used is here when they were renamed by the so-called colonists and naming them after the so-called terms so-called used and what they misnomer as England when England is actually here. Let's prove this. Middlesex County, New Jersey was named after the original Middlesex County located in southeast England. The first recorded reference to Middlesex as a place name occurred as early as 714 AD. The name was used to designate the lands of Middlesex Saxons, to distinguish the land from Essex, the land of East Saxon, and Sussex, the land of South Saxon, and Wessex, the land of West Saxons. These are actually terms for counties in what we call New Jersey, which was one time called Jersey when it was under the Church of England, under the house or historical house called the House of Plantagen, ruled by King Godfrey V, the Count of Anjou. The present-day English Middlesex County is surrounded by Buckinghamshire, Surrey, Kent, Essex, and Hertfordshire. The City of London, which is an independent county borough, is located within the Middlesex County and taking up most of the county's land area. While Middlesex County still exists in England, its government functions were subsumed by Greater London in 1965. So they're still subject, they're being overlooked by London, by the United Kingdom under Queen Elizabeth II. But they're not under the jurisdiction of the United Kingdoms, i.e. United Kingdoms of Britain. They're still subject to the jurisdiction of the Kingdom of England that was established by the kings and queens of England prior to the British monarch system being set up in 1714. Okay, as you see here. You see here to my right, you see a picture of the Pangaea, Eurasia, North America, South America, Africa, and Antarctica, and what is that? Australia. All right? So it says here. Between 350 and 260 million years ago, these four smaller continents drifted back together to form a Pangaea, which was the first verifiable supercontinent. From the formation of Pangaea until about 2,000 million years ago, the area that comprised present-day Middlesex County is believed to have been located close to the center of this new supercontinent, attached to what is today the northwest coast of Africa. Did you hear that? It says it right here. Let me blow it up a little more if you guys can see it. Me lower back down. I want to mess the screen back up. Okay. You guys should be able to see that. Between, which was the first verified supercontinent from the formation of Pangaea until about 2,000 million years ago, the area that comprised of present-day Middlesex County is believed to have been located close to the center of this new supercontinent, attached to what is today the northwest coast of Africa. The Appalachian Mountains in the eastern United States and the Atlas Mountains in the modern Morocco were once part of a single chain of mountains. These mountains chain was formed as a result of the continental plate collision between the continent of Baltica and Laurentia that formed part of Pangaea. So this ain't coming from me. This is coming from the so-called Freeholders on the history of what we call Middlesex County, which resides in the state of New Jersey, which was called Jersey when it was under the jurisdiction of the church. So that means that Middlesex County should be under the jurisdiction of the terms called shires, which was a term used by England when they were under the authority of the so-called church. All right, brothers and sisters? Now, check this out. Anybody ever heard of Albert C. Barnes? This is the book, A.C. Barnes, Revelations, Connecting Noah's Descendants to the Present. Now, this book is very important. I suggest that you brothers and sisters get this book. Because if you look on page one, of the same book, part one, in the beginning, Map of Pangaea. This is a European, brothers and sisters. All right? It says, many millenniums ago, during the period of Pangaea, continent was joined as one landmass. The Middle East, our area, was part of Africa and connected to Egypt, the Sudan and Ethiopia. The Garden of Eden was located in the area which is today known as Ethiopia in the Middle East. Within the Garden of Eden, four rivers flowed throughout the land. The four rivers were Pishon River, which today is the Persian Gulf. All right? So now, as we can see, this is one was one supercontinent as one. So now we know that New Jersey is the coastal. It's coastal. You know what I'm saying? So, and New Jersey is considered the Garden State. So this is where the Garden of Eden come from. Now, check this out. In the same book. Page 85, let me just find it. Same book. As you can see here, he starts talks about the Almax. You get this book, you can read on to it. But he makes, and we know that the Almax were called the Mississippi culture, who dealt with the Mississippi mound builders up on down through Mexico, all the way up to Mississippi and Ohio. Okay, on the very next page, page 96, it says the Almax cultures are the scoped. Let me go here in this page right here. It says, right here. I don't want to slip. It says over 170 Almec monuments found area, and I don't want to read that. Just start from here. They had early achievements in art, perhaps the most incredible findings from Almec culture. Almec cultures are the sculptures. The Almecs used wood, basalt, and jade to make their statues. The wooden artifacts are the oldest in Central America. The Almec civilization is the mother culture of later Central American civilization. Okay? Back in Africa, the Carthaginians and Phoenician tribes in Africa later interacted with the neighboring Berber tribes of Libya. They taught the Berbers their alphabet and math. With the new knowledge, the Berbers had adapted their own form of writing and expanded the way of the living to the urban metropolitan way of life. Now, you got to watch that because they mix truth with lies. But they're associating with the Berbers, with the Almec, and the Almec with the Pangea. And Pangea is associated with Middlesex County, according to the Freeholders. Now, we know that the Berbers was a history that goes back further than the so-called Moors or Moroccans, because that history comes from English, i.e. identified as the Anglo-Saxons. And if you look at the Berber-Saxons family crest, they said they're the Berber tribes who were made, the Anglo-Saxon tribes made up of Berbers. I already produced that in my further videos. If you actually watch them, you will see that. But we're associating with Berbers, Almecs, all associated with North America, and going all the way down to Middlesex County, which was the middle, or considered the middle seat of what we call Pangea, relative to it before it broke away from the big Pangea, where all the continents were associated, or all connected. All right, let's go down a little further. It's still here. Get this book. It's very important. This is coming from the Freeholders. Here you see, you talk about the Lenape Native Americans, right here. But I'm going to go to one to get to. Because they tell a lot of lies. But you got to be able to sift through these lies. All right, let's see right here. Right here, page 15, European exploration and settlement. It says, the Dutch, the first European explorer to see New Jersey was probably the Italian navigator Giovanni Capitus, unless as some believe the Vikings were here before him. Better known to most Americans as John Cabot, he sailed to North America aboard the 50-ton Matthew in 1497 for King Henry VI of England. So now, why is England associated with America And how did they know about America if America was not under their jurisdiction? So these people are using the history of England to substantiate their invasion, which is clearly a lie, because it said that he was an Italian navigator sent by King Henry VIII, the Sixth. Come on now. It was upon Cabot's early exploration that later English claims to North America were very base. It was not. No, it was not. He was an Italian. He was given the authority to do what he did, according to this so-called story being told by the Board of Freeholders by King Henry VIII of England. Now, at this time, King Henry VII, King Henry VII was part of what they call the House of Tudors. Have you ever heard of that? The House of Tudors, and after the House of Tudors, you had the House of Stuart. So now England was in, England being under the Norman invasion, under the authority of France, went through a mass dissolution. This is why King Henry VIII destroyed the monasteries in England. It says, it was upon Cabot's early exploration that the later English claims to North America were based. That's a lie. All right, we ain't gonna read no more of that. Let's go here. They ain't talking about English. Henry Hudson. All right, in 1609, an Englishman, Henry Hudson, selling for the Dutch East Indian Company. Now, how could it be English when he's selling for the Dutch? He must have been a trader for the Indian Company on the 80-ton yacht Howe's Moon, or Half Moon, reached North America in search of Northwest Passage to Spice Island in India. On September 2nd, 1609, he anchored in the Raritan Bay, nearly called what they call Sandy Hook. It's going out for a little further bay. We know that those are both lies. Let's go here. And right here, this is where I'm going for right here. It says, although it was unwilling to give, let me go with the paragraph right above it. Van Werkhoven commissioned Augustine Hermans to purchase this federal land from its Lenape inhabitants, so-called Native Americans. Hermans eventually purchased a tract of land beginning at Austerkill in the east and extending from Raritan River in the south to Pacific River in the north, including all the present-day Middlesex County north of Raritan River. Now, remember, they named it after Middlesex Shire, which was in England. But now it's being renamed by so-called voyagers under the authority of so-called England, which don't sound too correct. Doesn't sound correct at all. All right? It says, this purchase by Hermans was the first real effort by the Dutch. So he's also associating this guy with the Dutch to establish a settlement in New Jersey. Now, New Jersey became New Jersey by George Carteret and John Berkeley, who received the charter by who? Charles II. So everybody who's coming over there claiming to be England or given charge by England, so I guess by assuming they're getting charters, they're so-called have the right to adopt the right as an Englishman, which is not the case. Because there were no British religious under the New Jersey Provincial Council under New Jersey Province. It was under the Church of England. Most of y'all don't know y'all history. It says, and he was eventually forced to choose between his holdings there and his land in New Jersey. He decided to keep Long Island and his New Jersey land reverted to the colony of New Netherland. All right. It says, although, let me cut this down. I hope you guys were able to see that. Let's go back up there. It says, although it was unwilling to give Van Werkhoven such a large monopoly, the Dutch government was still anxious to establish settlement throughout New Jersey to solidify its claim to this territory. So they made a claim of the territory, but the territory was not theirs, which it believed to be of great value. Cornelius Van Tienhoven, an important official of the New Netherland colony, whose high-handed declaration provoked three wars between the Dutch and various Native American tribes. Did you hear that? To various Native American tribes. Now, we're going to prove that these tribes were Anglo-Saxon tribes, which were Native American Berbers. It says, force provoked three wars between Dutch and various Native American tribes. once described the Raritan Valley as the handsomest and pleasant country that man could behold, with abundance of maize, corn, beans, pumpkins, and other fruits. In 1661, the Dutch government, in an effort to entice new settlers into New Jersey wilderness, described the area in glowing terms. You can read it for yourself if you get this book. All right? So now they describe that this guy, Cornelius van Tienhoven, an important official of New Netherland colony, who had a high-handed depredation, provoked three wars between the Dutch and various Native American tribes. All right? So let's lock out of here. Make sure you download this article or get this article. This is what it's called. A lot of information up in here. Let me go back up to the top. We're almost there. Middlesex County Board of Trustees Freeholders, and the topic is the History Guide to Middlesex County within the state of New Jersey, which at one time prior to its incorporation was called Middlesex Shire, right? And Jersey, which was called Berwick of Jersey or Channel Island, which was under the jurisdiction of the House of Plantagenet, before you had the War of the Roses. Between the Yorks and the Lancasters. All right, so let's close out of here and go deal with this war, provoke wars between the Dutch and the Native Americans. Give me one second. I don't know how I was disconnected. I told you I need a new mouse. Not a mouse, but a stand for a mouse. Come on. By the way, this is my grandfather, Native American. His name is the oldest Jefferson. And the oldest is a surname that comes from England. All right. Anglo First Anglo-Saxon Dutch War. Now we're talking about here and what we misnomer as America within the United States. We're not talking about England. All right, my brothers and sisters, we're not talking about what they misnomer as England. We're talking about England here, which is now called North America, United States. All right. Now you notice in that article by the Freeholders, it says the Dutch and the Native Americans. The Dutch and the Native Americans. All right? This is the first. Can you brothers and sisters see that? Let me just go out of here. Okay. First in Dutch War. So now they use, when they set up their system, they use Native American Indians. But prior to the system being established, it was under the jurisdiction of the church, which identified the natives here as Anglo-Saxons. All right? It's just the first Anglo-Dutch War, or simply the first Dutch War. All right? So it says the first Dutch War. So the only first Dutch war they could be talking about dealing with what was said by the Freeholders was the war set up by Cornelius, whatever that guy's name was, by way of conflict with Native Americans and the Dutch. This is the war they're talking about. He said it was an entirely conflict fought entirely at the sea between the navies of the Commonwealth of England and the United Province of Netherland. Caused by disputes over trade, the war began with English attacks on Dutch merchant ships, but expanded, you see that, expanded to vast fleet actions. Okay, let's look at who these two people are. It says the Commonwealth of England and the provinces of England. They were all called, they used the term provinces back then. All right, Commonwealth of England. This is dealing with Oliver Cromwell. You see? You see, King Charles I was the father of King Charles II, who were all grandsons of King James. Alright? So now, we're dealing with a whole history of family tree from the House of Stuart. Alright, now we're talking about, that's the Commonwealth of England, right? This Commonwealth of England, it says here, the Second English Civil War and the trial and execution of Charles II. They was at war with what we call, let's go back here, the United Provinces of Netherlands. Let's look these people up. The Dutch Republic. All right? So what other proof do you need? They're masking themselves by names. Let me go back here. The Dutch Republic. History. All right. So all this dealing with Rome. All this goes into Rome. Treaty of Utrecht. All this is history that you guys got to know. It would be crazy for me to try to explain this to you. I'm just giving you key points. So that means that the Commonwealth of England was at war with the Netherland Dutch Republic. All right, let's go back here. Let's go a little further with the common, with the United Kingdom of England. Let's go back here. French Anglo Dutch War. Let's go back here. Let's see where the jurisdiction of what the Dutch were working with. The Anglo-Saxon were working with, not the Dutch. All right, let's go here. I think I've seen the term down here. Actually, 70-year war. Where is it at? Anglo-Dutch War, right here. All right. Anglo-Dutch Wars were a series of conflicts right here. The Anglo-Dutch War were a series of conflicts mainly fought between the Dutch Republic and England. All right? The first three occurred in the second half of the 17th century over trade and overseas colonies. Did you hear that? Overseas colonies. Now, let's go even further because we know that the Anglo-Saxons were Berber tribe, and the Dutch are derived from the Netherland people. So let's look up this term. It's called Anglo-Saxon Protestants. White, W-H-I-T-E. Here we go. Check this out. White Anglo-Saxon Protestants. White, can we all see that? It's going to clear the confusion up. White Anglo-Saxon Protestants are social groups of white Protestants in the United States, often of British descent. You see that? Of British descent and typically wealthy and well-connected. The group has a long-dominated American society culture and leadership of major political parties and has a monopoly on elite society due to intermarriage and nepotism. Did you hear that, my brothers and sisters? Through intermarriage and nepotism. This is how they become wealthy by way of monopolizing the world with the elite that they have, specifically in the United States. It's under the British monarch system, under King George I. That's Rome, right there. That's Rome right there, brothers and sisters. So what other proof do you need? Who were Protestants? Let's look at who these people were. On the history. Okay, when you get into the history of King Henry VIII, this is the reason why the Sexual Via Trust account was created, i.e. your birth certificate was created. Because King Henry VIII destroyed the church. So he had to set up a trust by way of you being subject to being born in a Roman system. This is called a vessel. And you dock when you get into your mother's womb. This created what they call a trust. This is why matters concerning true English nationals cannot be heard in any jurisdiction but a probate court. Because the birth certificate is actually called a living, willing testament, which is a trust. By you being born in the flesh is lawful conveyance from a divine person, which is lawful conveyance of a divine trust to a true trust by way of the divine energy and spirit being created into that living vessel, i.e. that physical body. So the only way you can be protected is by spiritual law, which comes under the authority of the church. The political separation of the Church of England from the Pope under King Henry VIII began Angelism, bringing England and Wales into the broad Reformation movement. All right, he protected us. Protestantism is diverse, being more divided theologically and ecclesiastically than either the Roman Catholic Church, the Eastern Orthodox Church, or Oriental Orthodoxy. Without structural unity or central human authority, Protestants developed to the concept of an invisible church in contrast to the Roman Catholic view of a Catholic Church as the visible one true church founded by Jesus Christ. So the authority in which the church was created pertaining to Jesus had to come through the church. A physical structure and true representation of the spiritual structure. Because as spiritual beings, you're divine. You're not subject to what they call the laws of nature. Because under the laws of nature, you're still what they consider to be an animal. How can we prove this? Because you do everything that an animal do. You eat. You sleep. You shit. You clean yourself. Spiritual people don't do this, or entities don't do this. So as a divine person, you gave consent to the so-called trust by being born, by way of being born in the flesh as a divine immortal soul, which created the trust, i.e. the living vessel, which is called, in what they call probate law, a living body corporate that has what they call a living trust corporate, which are assets within the trust. And that birth certificate is actually called a settlement certificate by you being born in the so-called Roman system. So the only way to add this is through what they call the church. The ecclesiastical church came under the probate court in 1857. So all matters pertaining to wills, estates, assets must be heard in the probate court. And every county has one. All right, so we see that the Anglo-Saxons or the white Anglo-Saxons were Protestants who authority came under Rome. do further research and you'll see what I'm talking about. Let's go back to here and prove that there's a distinction between white Anglo-Saxons, Protestants, and true Anglo-Saxons. Go, my brothers and sisters. I'm giving you proof right here. You know, I'm just giving to you what was revealed to me. That's all I'm doing. Many have eyes to see but choose not to. Hold on 1 second, let me go to it. They don't want to give me division of one. Berber. There we go. See that? Berber history, family, crest, and coast of arm. This is England. Origin available. You see that? This is England. All right? That's the crest of arms. There's the fleur de lis, symbolic of the descended down from God. That's what the four of these fleur de lis represents. All right, history of the name Berber begins with the Anglo-Saxon tribes of Britain. So when it says that, the Anglo-Saxon tribes of what we now are under the jurisdiction of what they call Britain, by way of King George I, now under the jurisdiction of the United Kingdom of Britain, under Queen Elizabeth II. So the word Berber is a baptismal, is derived from the baptismal name, meaning son of Barbara. You see that? In some instances, the name may have also been nicknamed for someone such as a Moor Berber who appeared to be of North African heritage. In such case, the name is referenced to the Barbary coast of Africa. This goes back to that Pangaea. That one big landmass, subcontinental land. You see that? What other proof do you need? There were Anglo-Saxon tribes. So I'm going to end this on this note, a reference to you getting proof by the so-called freeholders who are just holding this land as custodians for the true descendants of the kings and queens of England, who consist of the tribes known as the ancient Berbers, who were actually overthrown by the so-called Dutch Indian corporations, Neanderthal corporations, and every other corporation that was set up on these lands prior to us coming to being aware of this. All right, so with that, I'm going to say peace.